Hello and welcome to Christian Connections. We hope that this program will bless you no matter where you are around the world. We're coming to you live from Studio One at LLBN. We have a great program ahead of us here today and two guests, actually, to be specific, who will be with us throughout the program. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Lawrence Garrity, and we'll have our group here introduce themselves before we go any further. To my right.
Oh, me. I'm Hannah.
Of course. You're
Hannah
part
Nicole.
Of the show, Hannah. And next to you, Dr. Garrity.
Larry Garrity. I'm president emeritus of La Sierra University and a passionate archaeologist. Been associated with the Middle East for more than 60 years.
Wow.
And in my spare time, I help out at LLBN.
As chairman of the board and a program host as well. Many of our viewers may have followed and seen Excavating the Bible.
Right.
That's a great program. We're going to talk about that also a little bit later on.
Hello, my name is Arwin Wild. I am the executive director of the new San Manuel Gateway College and part of the Loma Linda Health San Bernardino campus.
Wonderful, which we're going to learn a lot more about it later on and what we're doing with it from an LLBN point of view. Marlon?
Marlon Paley, LLBN volunteer.
Hannah, what we have here for music today?
Yes, we have one more guest you want to introduce to our viewers tonight, and that is Gigi Novell, no stranger to as an LLBN, a great friend of the ministry and a great singer as well. She's also an assistant professor of nutrition and dietetics at the Loma Linda School of Allied Health Professions. But today she's our musical guest, and she'll be singing for us her first song, which is I'm Not Ashamed of the Gospel.
We're an anchor for those who are hurting. We're a harbor for those who are lost. Sometimes it's not always easy bearing Calvary's cross. We've been ridiculed by those who don't know Him, and mocked by those who don't believe. Still I love standing up for my Jesus, 'cause of all that He's done for me. That's why I am not ashamed of the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ. No, I am not afraid to be counted, 'cause I'm willing to give my gospel of Jesus Christ. For every moment His hand has held mercy. For every moment His hand has all the love that He's shown all my life. Love standing up for my Jesus and for all that He's done for me. I'm gonna believe that he's coming soon, and that he wants all the best for you and me. I'm not out to please the whole world around me. I've got my mind on eternity. That's why I am not ashamed of the gospel. Gospel. No, I am not ashamed of the gospel. I've got too much behind me to let this world buy me to stop. He's a name, but to me, he's my everything. I am not ashamed of the gospel. Of the gospel, I've got too much behind me to let this world buy me to stop. He's a name, but to me, he's my everything. I am not ashamed of the gospel. The gospel. No, I am not ashamed of the gospel.
Amen. Thank you, Gigi, for becoming a new faith partner with LLBN Ministry. She's been blessing us here for the last several weeks.
Several years.
Well, last several weeks, nonstop.
That's right.
Right? And so grateful to have her. Now, we'll ask Gigi later on about if someone who's interested in her music, how they can invite her to their church or their organization. Well, I think the time now for us to start with our guests to learn more about them. Marlon?
Well, thank you, Ganim. Now, we're here to talk about the latest addition to the Loma Linda University Health System's extended campus lists. And this is an unusual campus. It's one unlike any other because of the services that it's going to provide and offer the urban community that surrounds it. Here to talk more about this new feature is the director, the executive director. His name is Arwen Wild. Welcome to LLBN, Arwen.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Now, this is kind of an unusual project for the Loma Linda University Health System, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yes and no. Obviously, Loma Linda is embedded in healthcare. And as they have seen the needs in the community grow, they have looked at those needs, and this is a outgrowth of that, of seeing those needs. The school that has also been a part of this dream is new and unique for the community and for Loma Linda University.
So what do you hope to accomplish with this school? I mean, we're dealing with a transitional period in a person's education in that situation. What is your bridge?
Well, first of all, let me give you a little bit of my background so that it gives you context of why I'm saying the statements I am. For the last 21 years, before I was asked to come on board as the executive director of San Manuel Gateway College, I've been working in the San Bernardino City Unified School District. I started out as a middle school teacher, and I had some mentors of mine and some principals that encouraged me to go into the administrative side of it. And for the last 10 plus years, I have been a principal at the middle school level.
So what do you like more, the interaction with the students or the administrative?
The students. Yeah. Absolutely, every single day. They're the ones that bring the energy and the joy to see their faces light up when they're learning, to have their curiosity and their energy keeps me young, keeps me going.
Favorite story about a kid?
Oh, there's many, there's many. One of my favorite activities, which I've always done, not normally done by a principal, but I always have made sure in my calendar that I had lunch duty. If I wasn't called to a meeting downtown at the district office or off campus, I would always be out there with the kids during lunch. And so one of the favorite things I do is I would kind of stand in the line because we had over 800 students that we had to feed. And so they had to take their turns. So there was a line, and when the students would get to the front of the line, I would ask them a question of the day. And sometimes it had to do with the news topic of the day. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it would have to do with, health. And so one of the things I would ask them, what are you going to have for lunch today? And there were several options, but they were all not that healthy. And then they would ask me, what are you going to have, Mr. Wilde? I said, well, they have these carrots and celery sticks, and they look really good to me. And they would scratch their head. Is that all you eat? I said, how do you think I got to be 6'6"?
So that's what I need to start eating.
I think you made our dietitian very happy here.
Wonderful.
Yeah, in fact, I think you just gave her an idea for a brand new...
Ooh, a brand new show.
Yes, on SLS, Smart Lifestyle TV.
Absolutely.
Ask the question there with Gigi and Arwen.
Love it.
Continue.
Anyway, the needs of the San Bernardino community obviously have shifted over the last 15 to 20 years. Part of that has been economic factors. It started out when the steel mill in Fontana started to close down.
I remember those days. I was here.
Yes.
When it was the powerhouse employer.
That was one of them. The railroad was another one.
That's right.
And then the final straw was probably when the base,
closed.
Norton Base, Air Force Base, closed down. And they started a transition. Those economic engines were the backbone of San Bernardino and the surrounding communities. Some of them have fared better than others, but San Bernardino took the brunt of having those middle-class jobs pull out of the city. And so since that time,
lost the tax base.
Lots of different
bankruptcy.
Factors. Yes.
How are they doing today, though?
They're on their way back.
Yeah.
And it's just like anything else. As you come out of any kind of a challenge, you only have one place to go. And so I know that the worst days of San Bernardino's economic woes are over, and they're starting to pull out of that.
Yeah, praise God.
And it doesn't look exactly the same as it did, but I know that it will come out ahead in the long run. In the meantime, though, there's a lot of families that were left there and or a vacuum was created. And so people who were seeking affordable housing because the housing market crashed, they migrated towards San Bernardino. So there's a lot of poverty in San Bernardino, and there's not very much hope for jobs. So part of the outreach of this building, which initially started as a healthcare provider because of the needs of the healthcare, and those needs have been greatly grown because of the Affordable Care Act. with more people being able to access insurance and to be able to access healthcare. That is what started this whole process of putting in a building in San Bernardino. During that process, a lot of talks with partners and a lot of outreach and how we can make this the best endeavor that we can. The mayor, then Mayor Pat Morris, said what we need is job training, and we need jobs so that our community can now start to reinvest into the community. So that is where that dream of the school came in. And that's when Dr. Hart approached me about a year and a half ago and said, actually, it was kind of funny how he didn't even ask me. He said, I need to talk to you about this project because I need some information from the school district. And at the end, he extended an invitation for me to...
join his school district.
Yes.
Well, it sounds like this is... the timing is incredible for this to come together.
Yes, it is.
And we were talking about the uniqueness of this campus. It's not just a campus for learning.
Even though it is, learning is going to be intertwined throughout all of the parts of the campus because it's still a learning environment, but it is a medical delivery model for how an urban community can access
healthcare.
Good healthcare and all of the specialties that they need.
And we're specifically talking about Adventist Health International, the SAC clinic, that is currently, well, not, is it still at the Norton?
Yes, it is.
Location?
In fact, that location right now services about, they have approximately 50,000 plus patient visits per year.
It's walk-in, outpatient.
Between the two buildings now, they're going to keep that one open. Uh-huh. They're projecting that they will be servicing up to 200,000 patient visits per year between the two facilities.
So you're going to have actually two SAC locations, one within the Gateway College and then one at the present location. Well, we have some pictures of what it looks like. And as a matter of fact, Gatum, their ribbon cutting happens to be tomorrow. And the Loma Linda Broadcasting Network is going to carry that ribbon cutting live. Anything you want to add, Hannah?
Yeah. No, I mean, it's going to be live tomorrow, exactly.
11:30 a.m. Pacific time, Wednesday, June 22nd. It'll be about an hour long.
We're going to see Arwen doing some presentations.
Very, live. Very short part.
Well, who do you have with the for the lineup of that?
Well, obviously, we wanted to, this is a collaborative effort, and there are a lot of partners that have made this possibility come true. So they're going to be all recognized. Tune in tomorrow so you'll know exactly who. I don't have the list in front of me, and I don't want to omit anyone.
Okay, so let's take a look at the picture, and you can tell us about this building. Now, we have it here on the screen. This is the artist drawing.
This is the rendering of the building. This is facing west. As you face west, the west side will be on the freeway. It's highly visible from the freeway. It is a monument to what can be and what I call the renaissance of San Bernardino.
How many classes are you going to be offering in this building? Rough guess, because I know you're just getting started.
Yes. Well, these are going to be certificate programs. These are not going to be necessarily degrees that students are going to be earning. It's going to be a bridge, hopefully, to continue their education. The building has been well thought out, and it's first class. And one of the things that we know is that we want to treat everyone that comes in through the door that they have a sense that they are valued. Not only valued as them, their persons individually, but they're valued because they are part of the family of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Now, are they all going to be Christians? No. But we want them to know that they have at least come in contact with what that would be like. And that's one of the things that we're aiming to do, is to build that culture of just acceptance and welcoming into this building. There was a comment that was made, and it didn't sit well with me when it was made. Somebody went through the building and they said, this building is too good for the people of San Bernardino. It broke my heart. Because they deserve the very best.
Absolutely.
One of the reasons we're doing the school is because we want to help the students that have all the potential that every other student has, but because of their circumstances that they were born into, maybe are not able to access that. So with that in mind, the whole idea of the college is that gateway. The gateway from the existing school system, which is doing a good job of getting those students ready, but because of all of their background and their families, they don't know how to access higher education on a large scale. So we're hoping to bridge that. One of the things that I did a little investigating on was trying to figure out how many students from San Bernardino have actually matriculated through San Bernardino. Through Loma Linda University. And unfortunately, it's not a large number. There are some, but it is not representative of what should be, being in such close proximity.
Yeah, the number of the population.
So what our hope is that the students in the high schools will come to Gateway College. We will be able to expose them to all of the different pathways in the medical field, not just the big ones like nursing and becoming a doctor or a dentist, which everybody hears about those. But then to connect them with mentors and coaches that will help them on their next level of education, all the while receiving a skill and the knowledge for a job that's going to pay a little bit above minimum wage and has the potential for them to grow into.
Well, that's the whole idea, is a foothold. You know, if you could give just about everybody a foothold, they're going to take advantage of it. But in today's economy and the way things are in the world, that foothold is pretty slippery.
And so extending hope, and that's what it really is.
Growing hope.
Absolutely.
For the community.
And the San Bernardino City Unified School District, their motto is where hope happens. Mm-hmm. But this is taking hope to the next level, because it's a tangible bridge for students that will be able to now take the next step in their education and to help the community.
So do you have a target age range, grade range?
It's gonna be open to all ages, but the group that we're recruiting are high school graduates, right out of high school. In San Bernardino, unfortunately, only about 30 to 35% of them go immediately into post-secondary education. So there's 65% of the high school graduates that are out of school. And for a lot of reasons. They have a lot of potential, they have all of the skills, but they don't have the opportunities. So we're hoping that this will be a bridge to that, and then also that they will be able to get a job and they can work their way through school.
So the ribbon cutting is tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And you're starting out slowly. I mean, it's not full bore.
No. Actually, the building will be ready. And then as of tomorrow, most of the furniture will be in. The SAC clinic will open with family practice and pediatrics on the 17th of July. Then we will move forward with the opening of the school in September and also the restaurant.
Fabulous. Congratulations. We only have a couple of minutes left on this segment, so I want to give my colleagues the opportunity, because I'm sure they have some questions. Maybe the educator here, emeritus, or has some idea. Ganem, or go ahead, Larry.
I think it's very exciting that people in San Bernardino will have a chance to access this kind of educational opportunity. What kind of opportunity will exist for them after they finish the certificate program. If they've done really well there, will the various schools at Loma Linda give them a break, or will they have to meet certain standards that everybody else has, or how does that look?
Yeah. Embedded in the programs, we're also going to be offering some college-level classes, because that's the other goal, is to make sure that the students feel like they can be competitive in, in a college setting. But the main goal is to connect them with mentors and coaches so that they can now have someone that can help them navigate to the next level. In the meantime, to be able to get a job so that they could help their family and themselves.
Well, before we pitch it back to Ganim, I'm going to give you the opportunity for the last word. Anything we missed, anything that you want to tell us and the community and the world about Gateway?
The main thing is that this is God's project, and it's planted in San Bernardino. And you are each welcome at any time to come over and see the building and see what we're going to be doing there. We're hoping that there'll be a connection there that will bridge Loma Linda University and San Bernardino so that Christ's grace will be shown throughout the Inland Empire.
Well, there you have it. That's Arwin Wild, Executive Director of the San Manuel Gateway College, a part of the extended campus of Loma Linda University Health System. Ganim?
And for those of you who cannot be there in person for the ribbon cutting, again, LLBN would carry it live from 11:30 to 12:30. There'll be full coverage of the entire ribbon cutting. And in the meanwhile, we ask you to keep this project in your prayers. Thank you. And Hannah, I think we're ready for some more music.
Yeah, it's going to go back to Gigi Novell for her second song for today, which is I Am Determined.
Till he has finished his purpose in me. born till he has finished his purpose in me. And nothing shall shake me, for he'll never forsake me. And
what an amazing song.
You know, I wonder if Celery and Carrots is a secret not only to height, but to a great singing voice as well.
It's true. Well, we hopefully get a few moments to also talk to Gigi at the end of the program. We'd like to learn more about her music and how could people inquire her service as well. Dr. Garrity, thank you for being with us.
Thank you for inviting me.
Was it about an hour drive to get here or more?
About that, yeah.
About that.
Mm-hmm. Depends on time of day.
That's right. It seems like it never works in your favor. It's always an hour or more. It's a busy freeway between La Sierra to Loma Linda. Mm-hmm. For those of you who don't live in the local area, it's about 25 miles, you would say, between La Sierra and Loma Linda. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But it's an amazing, amazing journey with the traffic that you encounter between La Sierra, well, between entire Southern California.
Right, right, wherever you are.
That's right. 60 years of archaeology work, mm-hmm. as just a side product of your other involvements and duties, but we're gonna focus on archaeology today.
Right.
60 years of archaeology, have you seen archaeology techniques and methodologies mature and grow over the last 60 years, or is it pretty much the same basis?
No question, no, lots of changes. I feel like I got started in the Stone Age, you know, when we would impose a grid on our site to begin to excavate. We had surveying equipment, and we had tape measures, and we had levels, and those kinds of things. Right. Now all you do is just bring a GPS unit, and you know immediately where you are. So nothing like what it used to be. And we used to have notebooks. We'd take, you know, notes on everything, and we measure everything. Now we have everything on laptops, you know. You That's enter true. The laptop, you answer questions that are there. So much easier. It used to be take months to get permission to get an aerial view of our site. Now we send up, you know, a machine that will obey our commands and take all the pictures we want, so.
It's amazing.
Many, many, many changes.
So technology has served its purpose.
It has served its purpose,
for archaeology.
Right. Makes it much easier and more accurate.
Really. Mm-hmm. How about the actual digging and recovering objects?
That is still pretty much the same. Many people sort of picture, you know, you out there with a pith helmet and a shovel and so on, but we actually, the two basic tools are a mason's trowel and a little hand pick. So we pick a little bit, clear the soil away, pick a little bit more, you know, and we still have to be as careful as possible because we don't want to break anything that we might find.
Mm-hmm. So how, I mean, this really takes a lot of patience.
It does, it does.
What does go through your mind when you're into this tedious process? Are you just primarily focused on that object, or do you drift off in other parts of history as you are discovering what you are working on?
Well, you know, of course, the context in which you're working, and so you do know something about the history. You know the kinds of things you might expect to find. You know whether you're working in a soil layer or whether you've got a firm floor or a mosaic, or if you're building with, if you're digging within the walls, of a, you know, by a city gate. So you know generally, usually, where you're digging and what you might expect to find, but you go carefully and slowly so as not to break anything, but to make sure that you're not making a mistake, because an object that is found is much more valuable when you know the context. And the context helps you to date and tell you a lot about the context. That's why archaeologists are upset at people who go treasure hunting, because they grab an object out of its context, and therefore it's not nearly as valuable.
And I'm sure they are even more upset these days of all the blow-ups taking place by ISIS in different parts of Iraq and Syria.
So much is being lost that we will never be able to recover. And the things that we do know and are in museums and at sites are just being destroyed. So it's a very upsetting time for people who are interested in ancient history.
Is archaeology coming to an end point that we have discovered everything needed?
No.
Or is it more of an ocean away?
When I was little and interested in becoming an archaeologist, I hoped that I would grow up fast so that I would have something to dig. But the more we work, the more we find, and the more opportunities there are. And of course, an archaeologist, when he digs at a site, doesn't dig the whole site, because you want to leave something for posterity, for people who have more and better ways of discovering what's there. You want something for them to dig and to check on the earlier results, you know, with newer methods. So there's plenty of work to do, and there will be for a long time.
And when you dig out an item, you don't get to keep it for a while for research? Do you have to release it immediately to the authorities?
You know, back in the days when I started, there were divisions of finds, and the government antiquities department would come by at the end of a season and look at what you found, and they'd say, we'll take this, you know, but you can have that if you want, and we'll take this, and so on. They always took anything that was gold, anything that was written, you know, the most important things, anything that would go into a museum. But the other things they would let us have. And so I've been responsible for starting a couple different museums, and those are full of the things that we were able to bring back. Even the things, though, that they wanted to keep, if we needed it for further research or study, they would loan it to you, and we would sign, you know, a document saying we'll return it by a certain date. But nowadays, most everything that is found, they want kept in the country, as is their right. And so very little goes out except for study purposes. We find it, we want to, you know, document it further, we want to make comparisons and so on, and so we will borrow it back, and then within a year or 2 years, we'll take it back to the country.
So is there a process when you discover something that It associated that object with the archaeologist who discovered it? Are there records kept of?
There are records kept, right? We're really good at keeping records, photographically, digitally.
Of your own, separate from the local countries, governments, or whatever.
Right. They depend actually on us. They always have a representative from the department who works with us. And as the director, I would take rounds every day and get people who are responsible for smaller units to report on what they found, and we would discuss problems and strategies as to how to go forward and so on. And every time I made one of those trips, I invited the representative from the Department of Antiquities to join me, so he or she was constantly aware of what we were doing. So at the end of the season, that person's job was to advise their government about, you know, how things went, what they should do, and so forth.
How many objects do you have to guess, estimate, that you have personally discovered over your 60 years?
You know, I've never really added them up, but it would be in the thousands.
In the thousands. That's
Thank
amazing.
You. That's
You're welcome.
Great.
You are a biblical archaeologist.
Right.
Define to us what that is.
Well, a biblical archaeologist does everything that any archaeologist does anywhere in the world, but they're especially interested spatially or geographically in the area covered by the biblical history and the time period that's covered by biblical history. So that generally would be the Middle East from the beginning of time is what a biblical archaeologist is interested in.
And why does it matter to be a biblical archaeologist?
Well, it matters for the history of that territory, but for a person who's a person of faith, You know, if you're a Christian or if you're a Jew, even if you're a Muslim, the three great monotheistic religions have their origins in the territory that biblical archaeologists are interested in. And so by digging carefully in that territory, it throws light, illuminates the messages and the history contained in those documents of those three different faiths.
I understand graves are somewhat significant.
Graves?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Where people are buried.
Mm-hmm. Right. So mm-hmm. have you ever discovered any graves or people buried mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. that is biblical or comes from biblical cities within the Bible? Or?
Yes. I've worked in many different tombs. In fact, at the site where we were working in Jordan, we found the only two tombs from the period of Herod that were Roman tombs sealed with rolling stones in the country. And they illustrate the kind of tomb that Jesus was buried in according to the account in the Gospels. So they are of particular interest to people who come to Jordan, to tourists, because of the nature of that find. Hmm. But you asked if people's mentioned in the Bible have their tombs been found. And the most famous, of course, is Jesus' tomb. I mean, there's some discussion as to whether it's the right place, but generally speaking, most folks agree that it's in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. That's a site that when Constantine's mother, Helena, became a Christian, she visited, made a pilgrimage to the Holy Land, and she asked Christians who were living in Jerusalem, where was Jesus born? Where was he crucified? And so they took her to a site, and at that site she had a church built over it. Mm. And so there's quite a bit of historical evidence as well as actual archaeological evidence for the authenticity of that site being where Jesus was buried.
Mm. How about structural?
Yes, that church that she was responsible for in the 4th century mm-hmm. AD still exists in part, though it's been built and rebuilt through time, so that the current structure that's there is basically a crusader building that comes from medieval times.
Are there other structures that you are aware of or being part of discovering?
Oh, yes, yes. I mean,
can you give us some examples?
At the sites where I've excavated, I found lots of tombs in cemeteries. The ones that are Roman and Byzantine are sort of cave-like in that they've been excavated into the side of a hill. And you have a stone door, for instance, in one case that's on a stone pivot, hinges. So you just push the door and it opens, you know. You can go into the tomb. And then there are niches where people are buried, where the coffins would be placed, or sometimes without a coffin, the skeleton would be put in these niches. One of these tombs that I excavated had room for 12 niches, and there were actually 60 people that were buried there. People buried people on top of other people in the tombs. It was cheaper than to keep stuffing people in there rather than building a new family tomb. Yeah.
From your studies and discoveries, mm-hmm. as well as your biblical background, mm-hmm. as you find all these things and connect the pieces of the puzzle, how does it feel to you when you put a story together along with an object? What does it do to your faith?
You know, I was first interested in the Bible because I grew up in a Christian home where the Bible was appreciated and revered. So I've always had an interest in the Bible. But I also grew up in the Middle East and used to travel to sites of biblical interest. And so I saw archaeologists at work while I was a kid, and I thought this would really be an interesting thing to do. And went to school, got my degrees and so on, and started volunteering first, and then ended up being a director of a project and making the major decisions. And it was very satisfying to find things that directly relate it to the Bible. I mean, I have found structures that are specifically mentioned in the Bible, customs that are elucidated, you know, biblical customs that are elucidated by finds. People's names who are mentioned in the Bible have found proof of their existence. Many different things that creates a context for the biblical stories that helps us to understand them better.
Did you ever become a storyteller to your children?
Yes, I have told many stories, yeah. One interesting story that I could tell you is, I mentioned the hard time we had at first getting aerial views of our sites and of our work. And we applied to the Air Force to get a permit, and it was very slow in coming. Months we waited. And one day, a helicopter...
Where was that?
This was in Jordan.
In Jordan.
Yeah. The helicopter was circling and landed right in our site, and out stepped King Hussein, the King of Jordan. He says, "I understand you're finishing up the project for this summer. Would you give me a tour?" So, of course, we were honored to give him a tour. And before he got back in the helicopter, which he was piloting, he said, "Is there anything we can do for you?" So I shared that we had been working for months to try to get aerial views of our site. And if he could put in a good word for us, we'd appreciate that, you know. He said, "Do you have your camera with you?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "Hop in." So I got in the seat next to him. He took off. He circled the site as many times as I wanted to. He dipped the plane, you know, banked the plane. Opened the door, slid open so that I could look straight down without anything between us and the ground.
And without dropping out.
I was, of course, cinched strapped in. Got my pictures. And then he said, "Any place else you'd like to see from the air?" And I said, "Well, the next site we want to dig is about 12 kilometers away. I'd love to get some, you know, pre-dig pictures." He said, "Never heard of it, but point me in the right direction. I'll take you over there."
So
we did that. He said, "Now what would you like to see from the air?" I said, "Oh, you've been very kind. You spent time and so on, and we appreciate it very much." So he took me back, landed, and then took off. So.
See, you're very kind. I would have just stretched it till he would call a whole army to come and get me out of his way. What are the most incredible, in your opinion, in your book, biblical discovery that ever been discovered to date?
Well, I suppose the most sensational for archaeology in general would be the discovery of King Tutankhamun's tomb, you know, in the Valley of the Kings in Egypt. That was in 1922 that was found, the year that La Sierra University was founded. Carter had been looking for that tomb because all the kings of the 18th dynasty, called the New Kingdom in Egypt, had been found in that valley except for King Tut. And he thought, it must be here. So he was actually searching for it. And so when it was found, and found with all the objects still in it, and with his mummy, you know, inside the mummy case and so on, it was just very exciting. It electrified the world. So I suppose that's the most dramatic. As far as biblical discovery is concerned, I suppose we would say it's the Dead Sea Scrolls. In the late 40s, Bedouin accidentally discovered caves where these scrolls that had been written between the 3rd century BC and the 1st century AD, so right during the time of Christ, before and after, the earliest copies of biblical manuscripts were buried there by monks who were living in the desert. And so the discovery of those scrolls helped people realize how accurate the transmission of biblical manuscripts have been. Because people could say, you know, that the Bibles that we have today, which are English, let's say, how do you know they're anything like what Jeremiah, you know, or Moses wrote when they penned their first manuscripts? And all Christians could say was, well, through faith we believe that people have accurately recorded it through time, but we didn't have proof. Now we have the proof that what is in our Bibles is the same thing as what was intended by the authors. And so all of a sudden we had manuscripts that were, you know, more than 2,000 years old and several hundred years older than the earliest manuscripts that we had up until that time. And so that gives us faith that what's recorded is what was intended. Right.
And it's real.
That's right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. I want to open up the floor for the team here because I'm sure they all have questions. Although I have tons more, I'm going to yield to them and see if anyone have any questions here.
Well, I'm curious, Dr. Gary, how you got into archaeology in the first place.
Well, I mentioned, you know, having grown up there in Lebanon, my parents were living in Lebanon, and having the chance to visit sites of biblical and historical interest and watching archaeologists at work, I remember driving to Petra, which many people know about down in Jordan. I was a teenager during my first visit, and it was the road to get there was not paved, and so my job was to get out of the car every time there was a rock in the way, you know, get that moved so that we could make progress. And it took 3 days between Beirut, Lebanon, and Petra to get there, whereas nowadays you can get there easily in a few hours, you know, down a paved road. So it was those early years, and being raised in a family that cared about the Bible and being interested in history and living right there where I had access to, you know, these sites of interest, it encouraged me to do further work and get involved in archaeology.
Mm. Yeah. I just want to remind people that you have a show on LOBN.
That's true.
It's called Excavating the Bible, and you can just watch the show and see all of this antiquities that we were speaking of. So don't miss it. Go online and get the schedule and watch it because it's really historical. What's the oldest thing that you've ever found?
That I personally have found.
Brick from the Tower of Babel or?
You know, yes, we have bricks from the Tower of Babel, believe it or not.
Absolutely fabulous. Wow.
Because we know, if you go visit Babylon today, there's a big hole. And Alexander the Great excavated that hole because that was the Tower of Babel, and he was going to rebuild it. Mm-hmm. So like any good person in construction would do, you want to get your foundation secure. So he got it all dug out, and then he died. He lost his life at Babylon because he got terribly sick and died there. So there are bricks around that he dug out of that hole, you know, getting ready to rebuild it.
So now it's a swimming pool.
And a lot of people don't understand that at La Sierra University, we have the largest collection of archaeological artifacts in the United States that relate to the Bible. It's a wonderful collection. Unfortunately, we don't have a museum that's big enough to display it. But we do bring those things to our LLBN program, and so people who are interested in that collection can see it on occasion when they look at excavating the Bible.
Now, I've got to hold those things. This is thrilling to a little clay lamp. It's like, wow, you know, where has this been? One more final question, and in all of your years, I know you work in layers in archaeology, have these layers ever offered evidence contributing to the theory of evolution?
I mean, evolution.
Yeah, do they intermix?
Well, each of those layers builds one on top of the other, right? And so the top layer would be your most recent, and as you go down, it gets earlier and earlier until you come to geological bedrock. And so we have evolution in a way because of changes and developments through time. So that's the evolution just means change. Right. In terms of organic evolution, everything that we dig is within the last few thousand years. And so there's no evidence.
No dinosaur bones.
No dinosaur bones. That would be hidden in the rocks, and we don't dig into the rocks. Those are paleologists who dig in the rocks. And we dig just above.
How about evidence of flood? Do you see any of that?
We have evidence of lots of floods. There have been many floods through time. But the theory that the layering we have in the rocks is a result of the Noachian flood is one theory that is debated, you know, as to whether that really represents the story that's in the Bible or if that was some other flood. But if you have a worldwide flood, the things that we dig would be above any evidence for that because we dig only where human beings have lived, and all of that would be post-flood.
Hmm. You suspect one day you'll be building that museum?
Yes. If there are any viewers who have an extra $1 million that they would like to share with us, we can build it faster than otherwise we would.
You heard it. Maybe we can split it 50-50 with LLBN.
After you've taken care of the Gateway College in San Bernardino, then you can contribute to the museum.
Absolutely. Dr. Garrity was kind enough to let us in his area on so many occasions. I suspect if someone in town and want to get a tour,
or we're always glad to. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Any last thoughts? We have less than a couple of minutes left.
Gateway, live broadcast tomorrow.
That's right. And Excavating the Bible, it's listed on our website.
Mm-hmm. That's right. I just wanted to add that for both Excavating the Bible and the Ribbon Cutting, we archive all these programs on our website. So when it's done, go to our website and you'll see all the episodes we've aired so far, Excavating the Bible, as well as some of the recent events, the graduations, that took place at Loma Linda.
There's a new program every week, and we've had it for more than 2 years.
Yeah. Has it been really? We have about 100 programs online. So
you got great people. Doug Clark.
Right. You
know, he's comes great, down yeah. for
from Washington
program.
State.
What a dedication to LLBN, especially when LLBN is just a volunteer ministry. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dr. Garrity, for not only being our chairman and our program host for our program, but also being a friend and brother in so many ways to so many of us here at LLBN. And it's Gigi,
yes,
before time runs out, you are a professional singer. So I know you volunteer your time to LLBN, but you are available. Your service is available. How do people get hold of you?
That's a good question. I was thinking about that. And the best way to get a hold of me is to send me an email at jnaval@lou.edu. I was thinking if I spelled my name Gigi, there are so many variations for my other email. So let's just keep it simple. jnaval@lou.edu.
N-O-V-A-L.
There you go.
And we will certainly add that information to our website. Yeah. So
our web team has that information, and they're working on putting up a page. So
that'll
be up
soon.
Thank you all so much for being with us. And we want to thank our today's sponsor for this program, Glory Star Satellite Systems, for sponsoring this program. And we look forward for other sponsors to help carry the ministry of LLBN. God bless you. We'll see you here next week at Studio One.